everyone. It's Wednesday, February 22 here in Manila. I'm Karen Davila giving you the head start of the day. Our guest for Hot Coffee today, we start off with Albay Representative Edse Lagman. We'll be discussing the push to amend the 1987 Constitution and the International Criminal Court's probe into the Duterte administration's drug war. And for something light this morning, later on we'll be joined by two of the stars of the first Filipino Amazon original movie, 10 Little Mistresses, Eugene Domingo and John Arcelia. First, the headlines. Today's big story is the Philippines officially joins the world's largest free trade deal. Philippine senators set to meet with European Union lawmakers to discuss the human rights situation in the country. And a House lawmaker believes President Marcos Jr. is secretly behind the push to amend the charter. The Philippines officially joins the world's biggest trade agreement. On Tuesday evening, the Senate ratified the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership with 20 senators voting in favor of the deal. Senator Riza Ontiveros voted no, while the president's sister, Senator Amy Marcos, abstained. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri believes RCEP will help various local industries become more competitive. Philippine senators are set to discuss the country's human rights situation with a visiting delegation of the European parliamentarians. The meeting will be held amid moves in the Senate to formalize its opposition to the probe of the International Criminal Court of the Duterte administration's bloody drug war. Sherry Ann Torres reports.
Six members of the European Parliament Subcommittee on Human Rights will meet with Philippine senators on Wednesday to discuss the human rights situation in the Philippines. Senator Francis Tolentino says the EU parliamentarian sought the meeting with the Philippine Senate.
We will convene a special 6+6. 6+6 would entail a dialogue coming from the Senate Committee on Justice and Human Rights with six members of the Senate Committee on Human Rights. I think it has something to do with everything about human rights. I think they're hearing the resolutions concerning ICC. Lahat na yon siguro.
The senator says they will issue a joint statement after the meeting. These comes as two resolutions have been filed at the upper chamber opposing the International Criminal Court's investigation on the bloody drug war of former President Rodrigo Duterte. These were filed by Duterte's allies, Senators Robin Padilla and Jingo Estrada, who penned Resolution 488 and Resolution 492 respectively. Padilla explains he filed the resolution not just to defend Duterte, but the country's sovereignty as well.
Dapat lang po talaga na depensahan namin ang una sa akin pong paniniwala sa pagkakataong ito bago po namin dinidepensahan ang dating Pangulong Rodrigo Roa Duterte, ang una naming dinidepensahan dito ay yung soberenya ng Pilipinas, yung atin pong kalayaan at yung ating kasarinlan.
For Estrada, he believes the ICC is meddling in the country's internal affairs.
The ICC is interfering with our internal affairs. They do not have any right to interfere whatsoever in our internal affairs. The justice system is working in our country, actively working in our country.
Duterte's longtime aide and now Senator Christopher Goh says he's willing to co-sponsor the resolution. He insists Filipinos should be the ones to judge the Duterte administration's war against drugs and not foreigners. This was echoed by Senator Francis Tolentino, who maintains the ICC has no jurisdiction over the Philippines.
We're not part of the Rome Statute. There are courts functioning in the Philippines. And the former president is willing to have to be under the jurisdiction of Philippine laws and courts. So yun ang ako na maglalabas ng bukas para hindi na sila. I will just manifest on the floor to co-author. Yes.
Yes, once it is read.
But for other senators, these resolutions have no legal bearing.
It is only the sense of the Senate. Ganun din naman sa House. There's no force.
In the meantime, the Department of Justice will be filing its final pleading before the ICC Appeals Chamber to insist that the justice system in the Philippines is working. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla also challenges the ICC to investigate drug cartels who are destroying the country.
Kung talagang nais ng ICC mag-imbestiga, pati nila imbestigahan yung mga drug cartel na sumisira sa ating bansa.
Sherian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Now, a House opposition lawmaker believes President Marcos Jr. himself is secretly behind the latest effort to amend the Constitution. That statement coming from Albay 1st District Representative Ed Selagman, despite the President's earlier statement that charter change is not his priority. House Committee on Constitutional Amendments Chairperson Rufus Rodriguez belies Lagman's claim. All right, joining us now this morning, we have with us Albay Representative Ed Selagman. Congressman Lagman, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen.
Well, all right, what made you say that? Do you have proof or evidence to claim that President Marcos Jr. himself is behind these moves?
You know, Karen, the super majority invariably dances on the baton of Malacañan. For example, the House approved with inordinate alacrity the postponement of the barangay and SK elections, as well as the Maharlika Wealth Fund, now known as the Maharlika Investment Fund. It is surprising that despite the President's pronouncement that charter change is not in his priority agenda, the Chacha Caravan is fast rolling in the House of Representatives. I don't think it is because the members of the majority coalition have decided to cut its umbilical cord from the President. I have a sneaking suspicion that the President has covertly acceded to the Chacha initiatives, although he appears to be distancing himself from such charter change. And I think Malacañan should be able to tell us, to tell the public the real score.
But then you do have, if the President says it's not his priority, it isn't just in the lower house, in the Senate as well, you do have genuine advocates of charter change. I mean, we know this, even if some don't agree, there are genuine advocates of charter change when it comes to the economic provisions. Could it be that it's really just the majority in the lower house that's initiating this? Let's say with a go signal of the speaker, does it have to be with the President?
It does not have to be with the President, but invariably, when the House would approve measures, like for example, the calling for a constitutional convention, it has the blessings, not only of the speaker, but of Malacañan.
Okay.
So, there has been no instance where such a movement would prosper without any go signal from the President. So I think there is a covert consent of the President to go ahead with the constitutional initiative. However, Malacañan can dispute this and tell us the real score.
Okay, but I'm curious, why would the President need to distance himself if ever your suspicions are true? Why do you think?
Well, in the first place, all previous initiatives to amend the Constitution
have failed.
Popular support. So I think the president might just want to distance himself from something which does not have a popular support, just like in the previous initiatives.
All right, it sounds possible.
But let Malacanang tell us the real score.
Okay, now just how significant is it, Congressman Lagman, that the House Constitutional Amendments Committee already approved this resolution that they are calling for a constitutional convention? In other words, with the three ways to amend the Constitution, there's already been a sense that the CONCON is the way to go. The fact that they've already first agreed on the manner instead of what to change, do you see this as significant, or it's really advancing?
Well, in the first place, I would admit that the CONCON is the most important and popular mode of amending the Constitution. That is granted. But now, how expensive would this enterprise be at the time we are facing so many economic problems which the government has to address? Mm-hmm. For example, I heard reports that the government is preparing 18 billion pesos mm-hmm. for the calling and operation of the Constitutional Convention. That is a huge amount which could address so many problems like the high rate of inflation, the lack of food security, the high level of poverty, and the low human development of the country. So I think while there is need most probably to make amendments to the Constitution, it is now out of step. It is out of time, and it is not seasonable. Another question is, why make it simultaneous with the barangay and SK elections?
They said that would be cheaper. That was what an expert said in the lower house. It would only amount to something like an additional 300 million pesos.
Well, you know, Karen, the barangay and SK elections under the law must be non-partisan. Any election for CONCON delegates will be partisan. It would taint gravely the non-partisan requirement of the grassroots elections.
Essentially, Congressman, what you're saying is a CONCON delegate election has to be really made separately in the truest, in the true essence.
That's correct. Yeah, you know why we do not hold the grassroots elections simultaneous with the national and local elections? Because we would like to have it insulated from partisan politics. But if you make this election of the CONCON delegates simultaneous with the barangay elections, that would really taint gravely the non-partisan character of the barangay and SK elections.
Okay, so as a whole, are you really against amending the charter? I mean, in concept, are you against it?
In concept, I am not against, because I think there might be some provisions which would have to be updated. But the enterprise should not be conducted now.
So now we're discussing, but when? Because it's already been many administrations in the past. It's always the question of when. And they'll say the next administration. When it's discussed in that administration, the next one. So I'm just playing devil's advocate here. When would be a good time?
The good time is when we are able to successfully address economic problems, which should be in the priority agenda of the government.
Well, but then, Congressman, you have your colleagues claiming that it is the economic it is the Constitution causing some of these economic problems. I mean, of course, if we speak with Christian Monsod, it's a whole different argument. But that's why there are 9 bills that are filed in the lower house, of which 2 are concentrated on changing Articles 12, 14, and 16, right? These are all economic in nature.
Well, Karen, I am consistent with respect to removing or liberalizing the economic provisions in the Constitution. I've always been against this move because I don't think that would be the attraction to investors. The real attraction for investors to come in would be, one, the ease of doing business in the Philippines. 2, the removal or elimination of official corruption. 3, the internet speed should be better. Then there should be a lower power consumption rate. And also there should be predictability in the policies of the government. Now, I think what would attract the investors now would be 2 major actions of the government. 1, to accede to the jurisdiction of the international criminal courts prosecutors in resuming their investigation on the war against drugs, and 2, to have former Senator Dilima released from prison after almost 6 years of odious incarceration. In the first place, once we agree to the resumption of investigation, we will just be following the rule of the Rome Statute that withdrawal is not a prohibition from the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court, because the jurisdiction continues until continues before the effectivity of the withdrawal. In the case of the Philippines, the effectivity would be sometime March 18 or March 16, 2019. So all crimes committed against humanity prior to that effectivity will be under the jurisdiction of the ICC. 2, if we accede to the jurisdiction of the ICC, we will not be considered as a renegade in the community of nations, and we would be able to attract more investors.
Now, also, but is that really true, Congressman? I mean, I want to challenge you on that. I'm really curious about the power of the ICC, considering that the United States doesn't even recognize the jurisdiction of the ICC because they claim it goes against their constitution. You have really big countries that don't recognize the jurisdiction of the ICC. So I'm curious, when we say we'll be considered a renegade nation, the United States isn't a member of the ICC. They don't recognize the jurisdiction. So why aren't they considered a renegade nation?
Well, in the first place, the United States was never a member of the Rome Statute.
But they helped found the ICC.
But they never became a member. In other words, they never submitted to the jurisdiction of the ICC. But the Philippines was a member for a long time. And we ratified the Rome Statute. We should know what we ratified. And in that Rome Statute, it is stated that withdrawal will not exempt a former member country from jurisdiction until the effectivity of the withdrawal, which is 1 year upon the notification to the United Nations Secretary General.
And, what if the Philippines refuses to cooperate? I mean, practically speaking, you already have your colleagues in the lower house, and now you have lawmakers in the Senate already coming out, I mean, supporting, not just, they said, supporting President Duterte, but protecting, so to speak, the sovereignty of the Philippines. No less than President Marcos Jr. saying he's always had an issue with the jurisdiction of the ICC. So what is really the power of the ICC? In terms here of discussing this academically, what can they do if the country refuses to cooperate? They can't try Duterte in absentia.
Well, yes, you're correct. But that would be because the ICC does not have that coercive power.
Yes. So what is really there? So what power is there?
Well, it would now be a reflection of the country's legitimacy in the world order, in the community of nations. That would really affect our relations with other countries who would insist that the jurisdiction should be adopted and we should be able to cooperate. Otherwise, they would have sanctions, like, for example, not investing in this country because the country does not uphold the international rule of law.
But you really believe that's a factor? I mean, you do have, I'm just challenging you here. You have Vietnam that has $20 billion in investments a year. Do you think that's a factor? I mean, considering Vietnam isn't a fully democratic nation, they're getting a lot of investments. So do you really believe that that's a factor in investments?
Yes, definitely. I would believe that because investors would like to have a safe haven. If we are not able to uphold international rule of law, then most probably this would be a deterrent for investors to come in. And also, when we talk of sovereignty, sovereignty is not absolute.
Mm-hmm.
When we enter and ratify international agreement, we surrender part of our sovereignty in favor of a rule of law, in favor of an order in the community of nations. So. I believe that these are very strong factors.
Yeah,
and if we read the Rome Statute, that jurisdiction applies. Even the Supreme Court of the Philippines ruled categorically that the ICC has jurisdiction over the country, despite our withdrawal at the behest of President Duterte. The court said that.
Okay, I'm curious, do you believe that our courts won't be able to dispense justice if a case is filed against former President Duterte and the other officials with the drug war? We did have two presidents that were convicted. So I'm curious, do you believe that our courts are not functioning and can't handle this case?
Our courts are functioning, but they are not functioning with respect to the crimes against humanity allegedly committed by the Duterte administration.
Mm-hmm.
And we cannot invoke complementarity. Complementarity means that the local courts have taken jurisdiction and acting on these cases. We have not, because no less than the principal alleged culprit, the former president, has never been prosecuted in court. No case has been filed before the courts with respect to his alleged crimes. So we cannot say that the justice system is functioning for all. It is not functioning. It is defaulting in favor of President Duterte.
Mm-mm. All right. And my last question, what do you make of your colleagues? I did ask Congressman Barbers this yesterday. What do you make of your colleagues who seem to be, in unison in defense of the former president? Some critics have said it's almost like they're lawyering for the former president instead of just allowing the wheels of justice to take its course.
Well, in the first place, I would repeat what I have said. the laundromat of Congress and cleanse the alleged crimes against humanity committed during the administration. We have no legal basis in defending President Duterte. President Duterte should defend himself in the proper forum. Now the proper forum is the ICC, because our courts, the judicial system, the prosecutorial system have defaulted.
All right. On that note, Congressman Ed Seligman, I want to thank you for joining me today. I hope to see you again, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this opportunity again, Karen.
All right. Thank you, sir. We're going to take a quick break. Head Start. We'll be right back. Head Start. The so-called disturbance fees are paid to two Philippine tribal groups as compensation for the use of their land in the controversial Kaliwa Dam project. Alvin El Chico reports.
Members of the Dumagat Remontado tribe from Quezon and Rizal did a Thanksgiving ritual before the turnover of checks as part of the package promised for the group's go signal to begin the construction of the controversial Kaliwa Dam. Each tribe receives 80 million pesos, or a total of 160 million pesos, for both Dumagat groups from Rizal and Quezon.
Ang ating pagkuha ng pre and prior informed consent ay naaayon sa tamang proseso. Marami pong pag-aaral at community consultation ang ginawa natin. Kaya po tayo ay umabot ng 8 taon.
The elders reiterate, no one forced them to agree to the building of the dam on ancestral lands which will affect their livelihood.
Ang desisyon namin ito para sumingayon at marating natin ang ganitong kalagayan ay nakabatay sa aming customary law na ito ay walang pumili, walang nanakot. Ito ay kusang loob. Ito ay dumaan sa tamang proseso.
Aside from the 160 million peso fund to be used for the improvement of their tribes, part of the benefit package is 1 million pesos per community per year once the dam is already finished and operational.
Kung ano lang yung ibibigay, sabi nga namin, mahirap naman kaming maghalaga ng kung anong gaano kalaki. Sabi niya, kung yun ang napapagkaisahan natin, yun po yung aming pinagtitiyagan. Dahil sa totoong buhay po, yun lang kami makakatanggap ng ganong pera.
But not all indigenous people in the area are in favor of the Kaliwa Dam project. Some members of the Dumagat Remontado are asking President Marcos to stop the construction of the dam as the proponents did not allegedly follow the correct process in getting the indigenous people's consent. The group is marching towards Metro Manila and is expected to reach Malacañang on Thursday.
Ngayon ay nagsisimula na ang tunnel, nagbubutas na ang construction ng Kaliwa Dam dito sa Teresa Rizal, na wala pa kaming malinaw na resolution of consent. Ganon din, ang alam namin ay wala pang mga kaukulang permit mula sa mga bayan-bayan at sa iba pang bayan na maapektuhan ito, na ang alam ko ay kailangan ito ng proyekto bago pa man ito magsimula.
Kami po sa MWSS ay bukas na makipag-ugnayan doon sa mga tumututol sa ating proyekto para maipaliwanag po ano ba ang benefits. Not only for the water for Metro Manila, Cavite, Rizal, and Bulacan, but also the benefits that will bring to our host communities.
The tunnel boring machine will tear through several mountains from Teresa, Tumurong, Baras, and Tanay towns in Rizal until it reaches Infanta, Quezon, where the dam will be situated. Alvin El Chico, ABS-CBN News.
A Philippine Senate panel begins its probe on the alleged human trafficking scheme at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport. Robert Mano reports.
The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee begins its probe into alleged human smuggling incidents at the Manila International Airport Authority. Senator Grace Po immediately identified what she describes as security lapses in a chartered plane flying to Dubai last February 13. Po said there was a discrepancy in the number of passengers.
Kailangan ipaliwanag ng PNP kung ilan talaga ang nakalipad papuntang Dubai base sa kanilang inspeksyon. Lalo na nakakuha din kami ng impormasyon na pito rin lang ang nakarating sa Dubai at sumakay sa onward flight pa Geneva at ang mga pangalan ng pasahero ay tugma sa pito na nakalista ng immigration.
Po notes the original general declaration attached to the PNP exit clearance only listed 6 passengers, while the Bureau of Immigration general declaration recorded 7 travelers. However, the PNP Aviation Security Group has a different passenger count.
Sinasabi ninyo, hindi lang 7 ang nakasakay. Sinasabi nyo, ilan siya mang nakasakay na pasahero? Tama ba yon?
8, Your Honor.
Ah, so 8. So, bali may isang nakalusot.
Yes, Your Honor.
The PNP AFSI Group said they received a tip of a suspected human smuggling attempt concerning the Dubai flight. However, they were unsuccessful in stopping the chartered flight.
Our inspector were not allowed to conduct the inspection because the door was already in flight or was already closed. If the door of an aircraft is already closed, it is considered as in flight. And the pilot in command of that aircraft, sir, is the pilot, and we don't have a contact on the pilot. So on my behalf, sir, I tried to call up CAAP.
I am telling the truth, sir. No one received a call from Manila Control Tower po from the group of PNP ABSEC.
Also present in the hearing is Glenn Ivan Juvan, the immigration officer who inspected the travel documents, including passports of the passengers. Juvan admitted that he was the one who added another name of passenger after getting clearance from his office. Juvan insists there are only 7 passengers and 3 crew members. He also named another immigration officer who helped him process the group.
Initially, sinundo po ako. Ako lang po mag-isa ng Globan po. Kasi po, isa lang naman po ang sinusundo for checking po. Some special flight. During that time, he actually helped me check everything and double check kasi nga po medyo maraming tao po during that time.
The MIAA for its part admitted to lapses in the February incident. MIAA General Manager Cesar Chong said, based on their initial investigation, their team did not check the travel documents of the passengers. This prompted Senator Rafi Tulfo to recommend the suspension of privileges of VIP passengers entering restricted areas like the tarmac.
So therefore, Mr. Chair, I would recommend ito mga VIP passengers, mawalang galang na sa kanila kung sino man kayo, stop na muna yung sasakay sila sa kanilang private vehicles at dediretso sa aeroplano mismo. From now on, they should be processed just like everybody else.
To avoid opportunities for human smuggling, the MIAA has designated a clearing center where immigration and security checks will be conducted for passengers of chartered flights and their baggage. Additionally, all security personnel are required to have an access pass, including those who will escort the passengers. The Senate panel says it will hold another hearing. Robert Mano, ABS-CBN News.
Switching gears now, streaming giant Amazon has released its first original Filipino movie, a murder mystery that will also tickle your funny bone. Here's a look at 10 Little Mistresses.
Tandaan ninyo, VIP ang mga bisita natin, ha? At ayokong mapahiya si Don Valentin. Nagkakaintindihan ba tayo?
Yes, Roxy!
Ako ang mauuna dahil ako ang reyna.
What? Reyna ba kay Vierna?
Ngayon na biyudo na si Valentin, umaasa ka na ikaw ang pakakasalan niya.
Hindi ko inagaw sa'yo si Valentin. Kahit hindi naman siya exclusive sa'yo.
Ano nga tong gathering na to? Paka-regressive? And yet here we are. Nakikipagkompetensya para sa iisang lalaki.
Ingat ka sa akin, baka biglang...
Tinanggap ang imbitasyon ni Valentin.
Masamang mangyayari.
Ano pong masamang mangyayari, madam?
Buenas noches, amada senyorita. At ngayong gabi rin ito ay sisimulan ko ang aking pagbabago.
Mukhang may pinaplano na naman niyang si Valentin. Ayoko ng mga pasurpresa niyan.
Ladies!
Kaya ko ba tayo kay Valentin? Hindi ba sapat na motibo yung 200 million na matatanggap ng bawat Kirida sa pagkamatay ni Don Valentin?
Grabe, Mr. Lee. Wala talaga nakakaligtas sa Blue Eyes mo, no?
I therefore conclude na lahat kayo suspects. Meron akong sasabihing sekreto sa inyo.
Shh! Pakinggan mo mabuti.
Kailangan muna nating mag-ingat. Gusto mo bang ikaw ang sumunod kay Valentin, Lily?
Ah! Agad? Teka, bawal magtanong? Double?
Sinutang flower, kandado, lunok susi. Tapos. Oh!
Anong una mong tinanggal? Bra, panty, o konsensya mo?
Kirida, parang nag-amok. Tignan mo yung ginawa nila.
Yeah!
Sabihin niyo na po sa kanila kung ano yung na-discover natin. Yung pabalong hawak na may dugo!
Bumatay kay Valentin!
Bumatay kay Valentin!
Close daw sa kanya.
Wow! Salamat sa clue. Ang laking tulong.
All right, joining us this morning, we have the stars of 10 Little Mistresses, Eugene Domingo and John Arcelia. Hello, Eugene. Welcome back, John.
Hello, hi. Hi, Karen. Hi, Don Valentin.
Hello, my love. Nagka-color coordinate ata tayo kahit di tayo nag-usap.
Mukhang okay. First of all, I want to congratulate you both for 10 Little Mistresses. So this is the first original film of Amazon Prime. I mean, locally produced, right? By Amazon Philippines. It will be streaming on Amazon. So I want to start first with John. I mean, clearly this has revived the industry. And why, what's so exciting about, usually, you know, Filipinos would come up with a drama film, right? But then this is very unique. It's like a murder mystery. It's very Knives Out. It's so in right now.
Well, you know what? If you're going to think about it, the stories about concubinates, about concubines, and there are other cultures who actually accommodate these kinds of relationships, no? But in societies like us, America, Philippines, somehow this kind of relationship is somehow unlawful, no? So, medyo restricted siya. Still, there is a social stigma. So, sa society natin, hindi siya masyadong pinag-uusapan, and it is a very delicate issue when it comes to Kiridas. Yeah. And I remember...
But let's not forget this is a comedy.
Yeah, I mean, that's why. That's why it's very interesting.
Well, yes. Wala akong kilala na may 10 mistresses. Yeah.
That's what makes this, made this unique. Because we're going to tackle this kind of situation in our society in a very comic way. And towards the end, there is a certain kind of liberation towards what should be the ano dapat yung konteksto ng babae at ng society na kagaya natin towards this kind of dilemma or this kind of stigma.
Now, Eugene, you play, is this correct, a blue-eyed mayordomo? Tama ba to? Can you explain?
Yeah, I play the blue-eyed. It's very important, ha?
Blue-eyed.
It's already trending.
Yes.
And you know, Karen, I really have to explain every time.
But
that
are you a mistress? You're not a mistress in the...
You know, Karen, as much as I want to divulge a lot of things for you, I don't like.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Because
so you are a blue-eyed mayordomo.
Yeah. The only thing I can tell you now is that Yes, my natural color is blue. That's it. And okay. The rest, please watch.
Yes, yes. No, but clearly no spoilers here. But we have John Arcilla, because I love movies like this. You know, those movies I've seen. I love murder mysteries. And
yes.
Okay, John. Okay, will someone kill you or someone will kill somebody? Why is it a mystery? I know your legal wife dies, so you call in your 10 mistresses. Is that correct? Because you want to choose a new wife.
Yes. Well, it's already kasi in the trailer. The main man. Well, there's a twist towards
the story.
The major man is died actually, and everyone is looking for the culprit.
Okay. But can we say who dies?
Yeah. In the trailer,
you
it's.
Die? You die.
It's Valentin. It's yeah.
Okay. And do they kill you for your wealth?
You've been asking a lot of questions.
Because this is so much fun.
There is some kind of moral parang mayroong moral aspect why.
And all right, but
that's what's fantastic about it, because it is not just funny but it's also dark.
Okay.
Now I believe, Karen, you really like murder mysteries.
I really do. Come on, I've seen them all. I've seen from the major classic ones.
Yeah. Okay.
The Christie types to the
Karen,
new ones like Jennifer Aniston and Adam Sandler.
Wait, Karen, this is a whodunit movie.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you now, you cannot predict it. It's a twist after twist. And I'm telling you, it's a lot better than Knives Out or Glass Onion.
Are you serious? I am so excited.
Yeah, now I'm very confident. Huh? Before it was, we had our premiere night, I'm like this. It's better than Glass Onion because I've not seen the full movie, okay? And then when we saw it after the premiere night, I'm like this already. Yes, it's a lot better than Glass Onion. Yes.
Okay.
And then Mario Dumawal said, Eugene, you're right.
Oh, wow. I'm so excited. But okay, let's talk about the other stars. I mean, in a funny way. So I know Agot Isidro posted herself in a red gown. She's one of the mistresses. So John, what are the characteristics of the mistresses?
There's parang two parang merong dalawang classification yung the millenniums and you know the first
the first wave and the second wave.
Meron dito yung older mistresses.
Yeah. Well, merong mahilig sa sports, merong mahilig sa may alahera. So yung different kinds of women na naisip ni June Lana na pwedeng he just wanted to tell the audience that anybody can be a querida, kahit anong status mo. You can be a woman, you can be a moneyed woman or lady, but still you can be a victim or you can be into that kind of thing.
Okay, and are they all funny and scheming, or you only have some that are scheming?
Again!
Eugene,
you are so cute. Okay, this is it. Karen, all of them, of course, because all of the cast are suspects.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so all are scheming.
But
the most exciting thing about the script of June Lana is that it is unpredictable. You think, wow.
Yeah. Or maybe
like that.
Parang compare din sa attack ni June Lana, kung saan niya ihuhugutan yung skimming na tendency nung mga queridas. But somehow, maybe not, maybe yes, pero I think that's actually the exciting part of that. Kasi parang sino ba talaga ang scheming at sinong hindi? Pag may okay. Not about the camera angle, it's just about a directorial ano or talagang meron ba. So it's the audience to find out.
Yeah. Okay, now let's talk about the industry as a whole. I want Eugene to answer this. With many streaming platforms now, I mean, you have Amazon, Disney, Netflix, and I don't know, I'm sure I'm missing out more. Few, I want TV, so many out there. Eugene, what's this been like for actors and the industry? I mean, the unique thing about these streaming platforms too is you're also seen regionally automatically, right?
Right,
one can just put this on Amazon US. For the Filipino audience there, I mean, that's the difference now. How has this changed, like, your career, and I'll ask later, John, and the industry as a whole?
Yeah, John would also agree with me when I say this is very exciting for us, especially because John and I, we started long before all these streaming platforms. So it is exciting that we are still here enjoying this development, okay? But of course, we miss the past. Like, everybody's using the film, and, you know, it's like there's another respect for that. But right now, you cannot be left behind. And this is like widening your market. And I want to touch on, like, for example, our friend and theater colleague as well, Dolly De Leon, is already, you know, it's already there. And it's like, this is the sign of the times. Right. You know, we are widening our market. And for us actors, this is really, really exciting. And I'm sure also to our writers, our directors, everybody here in this industry is really excited about this. And it's about time, you know, because this is supposed to be really global. There are many stories, many possibilities. We should really be riding. We should move with the time. So, right, John?
Yes, agree. Yeah, okay, John.
Well, kasi definitely the Filipinos, Filipino filmmakers have already penetrated the international scene, especially hindi man siya super mainstream.
Like Korea. Hindi pa tulad ng Korea.
Yeah, hindi pa tulad ng Korea. But somehow, may dalawang effect ito sa Filipino filmmakers and actors. First is, well, nandito na ang lahat ng platforms na ito. Nandito na ang Prime. So, pwedeng hindi ka na kailangan mag-exert ng maraming effort na kasi nandito na sila. You just have to be there. You just have to be available, and then it's going to be a window into for the global film makers na makita nila ito pala yung Filipino, hindi lang ito yung pwedeng ipakita, ito dito talaga yung mga pool of talents ng Filipino. So somehow it will really open a lot of doors to all Filipino actors.
Okay, I'm curious, you know, streaming platforms like Apple, Netflix, I mean, Amazon in the US, they take care of certain Hollywood stars. So they take care of stars, have them under contract, and then they do repeat, diba? You have movies, makikita mo in the platform, paulit-ulit na sila. Are we in that state, Eugene, John?
I think we're going there, hopefully. We are just starting, and because I'm hearing some, you know, plans, and it's really in that direction.
Yes.
So I'm happy sooner or later.
Yes, I'm really happy because, I mean, with the non-renewal of the franchise of ABS-CBN, I think it's also it's hopeful to see that we have many, many stars. We're back working, right, John?
Yeah.
Yes, definitely, yes. Wala, may iniisip ako kanina na wala. Sige,
go ahead,
Eugene.
Eugene.
Yeah. And one thing that I have observed, and I know John will also agree with this, is that not only in the aspect of filmmaking that we are trying to, you know, be on their level, diba? We are trying to lift our standards because we are widening our market. It's also in the promotion.
Tama.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My God, I really would like to congratulate Prime Video for all these promotional that we're watching right now. We're seeing right now in the social media.
Yeah.
This is the pinakabongga promotion that I have experienced so far.
I'm so happy for you.
I want to clarify on the paulit-ulit na. Do you mean the content? Karen?
No. I meant if you look at streaming platforms, international ones, you'll see that they put in under contract specific stars. So like, let's say Ryan Reynolds for Netflix. Yeah. Then you'll see, what I mean paulit-ulit, meaning you'll keep seeing him in different produced Netflix films.
Oh, yes.
That's what
yes,
I meant.
Yes.
Are we there?
I think Dali's parang appearance in a lot of in this major award giving bodies really put the actors the film actors in the world map, no, in the map. So I think that will really add interest to a lot of film producers around the globe, no. Well, BAFTA, that means the British film dom. I mean, well, she was not actually nominated in the Oscars, but she was seen by a lot of good critics.
And she will be there. She's going to attend the Oscars anyway.
Yeah.
The film.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think on that note, well, to close, unfortunately, we don't have enough time, but I will be watching for sure.
Thank you, Karen.
So when is it streaming? I guess, Eugene, can you share? When is this streaming?
It's already been streaming, and we've already, yes, and the reaction of the audience is so exciting, and we are so grateful. Everybody in Prime is happy. Idea First is happy. All of us in the cast are happy. I think this is a very, very good start. So thank you very much. Thank you for this opportunity.
It's streaming.
Please stream legally.
Yeah. I love that.
Thank you, Karen.
Please stream legally. Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. John Arcelia and Eugene Domingo. Thank you. And I do hope to see you again soon in person. Who knows?
Right? Yes, Karen.
You take care.
Thank you.
Good luck. Let's get started today, everybody. I'm Karen Davila. So you know what? Catch 10 Little Mistresses. Watch it on Amazon Prime. And watch it legally, as Eugene said. Stay informed and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to